You came to court with the DNA that proved that you didn't do this.
Yes. It felt like I was in a dream, in another world. So I pinched myself, and when it hurt, I said, well, it's no dream, you know. And so I entered the courtroom, and, you know, it was right foggy, like, you know, I saw my family, my attorney and their families, and the district attorney, you know, he called out the charges, and Your Honor, you know, the judge told me to stand up. I stood up. He said, the charges against you have now been dismissed. You're a free man. You can go home, you know. And everybody started embracing each other and crying. And, you know, like I said, they said that grown men don't cry, but that's a lie. I cried many nights, you know, because I was hurting inside. But I had to do what I had to do.
How did you get to hear about this?
They came to my house, the officers, and the district attorney came to my house to tell me that the DNA test had come back and that it did not belong to Ronald. It belonged to Bobby Poole. And, you know, there's moments in your life that you just don't remember. And that's one of those moments. I think that it was like being swallowed in like a black hole. And I just remember crying. I remember feeling tremendous guilt, incredible, paralyzing shame, but the biggest emotion I felt was fear. I mean, I was terrified.
Why was that?
Because here was this man who had been in prison for a third of his lifetime because of me, and he had to hate me, and I would hate you. And so I just knew that he was going to come after me. He was going to hurt my children. He was going to somehow have revenge and take something from me because I had taken something from him.
After some time, you decided that you wanted to meet Ronald. Mm-hmm. How did you go about?
I was stuck. I could not get his face out of my nightmares, even though it didn't belong there. I couldn't remove it. And I knew the only thing that I could possibly do was know the man, because I didn't know the man. I only knew what I had made him out to be. And so I asked the detective who had worked on the case if he could set up a private meeting in a church not far from where I'd been raped. And he was kind enough to do that. And well, I just started
crying. What did you say to him?
Well, I was sobbing so loudly. But I looked at him and I was shaking. And he was looking about like he's looking now, very calm. And I said, Ronald, if I spent every second of every minute of every hour of every day for the rest of my life telling you how sorry I am, will you ever forgive me? And he did the one thing.
What did you answer?
Well, I reached over and I grabbed her hand and I told her that I had forgiven her years ago because that was the thing to do. You know, I felt in my heart, I don't want to, you know, suffer for something, you know, I did not do. So give me the strength to forgive her and move on further, you know, one step at a time.
Would you have been able to?
I'm not sure. I'm thinking of, and I'm amazed by the grace you must have been to ever since that you've handled this right. situation. And would you say that you're a man of very strong faith? Because it seems like that's where you go. And if you are, would you have been able to handle your life and this horrible situation in the way you have without your faith, would you say?
I would have very much so, you know, because my family, they stood behind me, they corresponded with me, they kept me uplifted, and to believe that one day things going to change.
But he does have a very strong faith.
That's what I'm like, because I can relate to your reaction mm-hmm. where you're kept awake mm-hmm. at night just mm-hmm. dreaming of killing the person who raped you. Yeah. It's much harder. I'm so impressed, and I've seen it before, you know, in people, and it's something very American, too, about your way of patiently handling your destiny, which obviously wasn't your destiny in the end, but patiently dealing with the situation, that's mm-hmm. so horrific. Mm-hmm. To be locked up even for 24 hours mm-hmm. and knowing that I haven't done this. Mm-hmm. To go and exercise, which is hard enough for somebody who just wakes up in a nice situation in life.
Right.
But to do that when you're falsely mm-hmm. accused of something and in prison is so staggeringly impressive. So.
Thank you for the show. And Roland Cotton, welcome to Scandinavia.
Thank you.
Actually, you are here now with a strong friendship.
Yes.